Hello, everyone, and welcome today to our session on Color Management Fundamentals in Nuke. Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you for your enthusiasm for the session. We've seen your subscriptions to the page, and we're really excited to have you here today. I would like to welcome our speakers. We have Victor Perez joining us. Hello, Victor. We have Carol Payne joining us from LA. Hello, Carol.
Hi, everybody.
And we have Juan Salazar joining us from London. I should point out Victor's in Italy, and I'm in Montreal, so it is a truly global webinar today. So welcome, everyone, and thank you for being here. We're really excited to talk to you today about color management. I just wanted to do some housekeeping and remind everyone, we just wrapped 10 days of Foundry Live. This is our semi-annual product release and roadmap presentations. So we had a lot of great conversations. If you're interested in taking a look, I suggest you take a look at our Livestorm page. They will also be in our YouTube channel in a couple of weeks with some English subtitles. So we would definitely love to have you take a look at some of the exciting things we announced, including Nuke 13, which was launched exactly 2 weeks ago today. So on March 17th, I believe we rolled it out. Today is actually also another cool milestone, because this marks exactly 1 year since we've been doing virtual events with Foundry. One thing I did want to call out on the virtual events with Foundry is we've had a lot of questions about how come Victor Perez hasn't done a webinar for us. Well, you're going to find out why today, because we've kept him locked up in his studio, diving into the fundamentals of color management. We have a couple of upcoming events that we're excited about, including GTC, which is the NVIDIA GPU conference, and our colleague Ben Kent is going to be diving into machine learning and copycat for VFX in Nuke 13. So I'll send you the registration link after, but if you're interested in copycat from Nuke 13, if you've heard about it, we'll do a deeper dive in a couple of weeks at NVIDIA's conference, so that's exciting. Also, I just wanted to point out one of the things that's important to Foundry and the industry, and where I get to spend some time working with Carol, is the Academy Software Foundation. So we're very actively involved in ASWF, as we use many of the open source projects, both in our tools and our customers use them in production. So we have representation on the board of directors, the outreach committee, and we're very actively involved in the technical advisory councils and various working groups. I always want to point out, to be successful, the ASWF needs community members like you to contribute code, get involved, and help spread the word about the great work they do on all these open standards. So please visit their website for more information on how you get involved. Oh, look at that. There's a new video on Foundry Learn today. So I wanted to call out as well, we've been investing quite heavily in our Foundry Learn content. This is tutorials, training, how-tos, skill-ups. And in the last year alone, the team added 400 videos on our products to help our community learn and skill up on our different tools. And about 11 minutes ago, we added color management fundamentals and ACES workflow in Nuke. So we're really excited about that, and you'll be able to take a look at it after the session. If you want to find out more about some of the work and some of the things our Foundry are doing, subscribe to our newsletters. You can follow us on social media. Subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. That's where we post a lot of our event recordings and a lot of our training tutorials. So there's some really great content on our YouTube channel. So please subscribe if that's your thing. We would love to have you there. Also, because it's our year anniversary, we want to give away some books. We've recently been working with Dan Smith from Crafty Apes, and he's made this awesome book called Nodes Within Nodes for Nuke Codecs. Some great content in there, and we're going to pick three lucky winners who attended today, and we're going to send them the link to download their digital version. So thank you, Dan Smith, for all your support of Nuke and all the work you've been doing in the community. Now, with that, the main event today is talking to Victor and Carol and Juan and our team on color management fundamentals. I won't take too long. I am going to say thank you to the team who are here today and just give you a heads up on where we are with our training. So this is a multi-series, multi-chapter series that we're working on. So Victor and And Juan will be telling you a little bit more about what's coming. But part one is available today, which is so exciting for us. And with Netflix's wonderful support, we've also been able to subtitle the content. So there's subtitles in English, but there's also subtitles in French, Korean, Portuguese, and Japanese and Spanish are coming in a couple of days. So hopefully that'll help our international audience out there. You can choose the language that you're most comfortable in, and the subtitles will be there. They've all been checked, so you won't have any weird technical words pop up, like the translation of a technical word. So part two is coming soon. Again, I won't dive into that too much. I'll leave that with Victor and Juan to talk about, but I just wanted to let you know what was coming. And with that, I'm going to hand the mic over to my colleague, Juan Salazar.
Thank you, Jen, and hello, everyone. And yes, color management, one of those topics, right? So one of the main things is exactly that. So with Foundry and with New Cozy, we have always been kind of, or tried to be at the forefront of color management. And obviously, Nuke has always been used and was designed to do multiple images with different sources and everything. So we tried to work in that way and make sure that that was the best way to work with color. Now, we have always been onto it to the point that back in 2016, we actually joined the ACES team and started developing a bunch of nodes to work with ACES as soon as we saw that this was coming about. To the point that we actually did all those notes and never released them at the end, because in conjunction with the ACES team, we decided that some of that was too early and that the real way forward was still to maintaining an OCIO. So we kind of took those out and kept continuing with ACES with OCIO. But things are changing and things are keep moving, and code management gets even more and more at the forefront of the industry. And one of the things that is happening right now is obviously the change to OCIO V2. So for those of you that don't know, the OCIO team has released version 2 of OCIO, which brings a lot of new things. You can see how Carol is really excited, because it has a lot of really good things there. To me, obviously, one of the major ones in there is obviously the parity between the GPU and the CPU. And just to let you know that we are already on an alpha of 13.1. So as Jen said, 2 weeks ago, we released 13. We are already on an alpha for 13.1 with the OCIO. So get in contact with us if you're interested. But this is very exciting news to push the color management forward. But saying that, as we were working on all of this, about a year ago, we ended up in conversations with Netflix about how we can help everyone to do color management. As you guys know, a lot of us on the team, we travel around the world. We see all of you in the different companies, in the different sizes of projects, and we can see where the struggles lie and what was happening. So a year ago, we started talking to Carol, and they invited us to help them with this training. So welcome, Carol.
Oh. Hi. Yeah. Thanks for having us here. I'm really excited that this day is here. It seems crazy that it was a year ago. I'm not sure time is real, and I'm sure everybody feels the same way. But yeah, my name is Carol Payne, and I work for Netflix on the creative technologies team. And we do a lot of work for Netflix around how technology is used to create the films that we make and the TV shows that we make and all the content that you see on Netflix. And we're always looking for the next way to create high quality content, the best thing for our creators and the best thing for our members that view it. And it's really important for Netflix to, you know, empower people all over the world to tell stories at the highest possible quality. And we want to acknowledge that a big part of this is color management is hard and color science is scary. And that is just a thing that's been the case in our industry for a bit, ever since, you know, with film, it was when we shot on film, it was, you know, a select few people sort of knew how to run that process and get that film looking great. And then we went into digital and there just became so many different cameras and so many different options and so many different ways to make a thing look the way you wanted it to. And it became really, really hard. And then we introduced HDR into the mix and it became even harder. And so now you're looking at, you know, we've got these cameras that are incredibly capable on one end of capturing really high fidelity information, high resolution, the high dynamic range. And we've got, you know, now starting to see these displays on the other end that are capable of displaying a large portion of that information. And so then the question becomes, oh, what do we do with all of our workflows in the middle? And how do we, and how do we make that accessible for people? And we're looking at this from a Netflix point of view, and honestly, from an industry point of view, everybody should have the same access to information and tools, and the ability to make great content with the best technical tools available. And having like what Juan was talking about with ACES and OpenColor.io being open standards, accessible to anybody. And then partnering with the Foundry, who's always been at the forefront of, you know, the latest and greatest in the film industry, and truly like focused on education and making things accessible from a place that is just very, very important globally. And that's why we're so excited with the localization on this, that, you know, these different languages, and we hope to keep adding more languages as they become available and things like that. But that's really where we started at with this series, and how do we partner as an industry? Netflix, everybody, Foundry, on Victor coming in from, you know, so much experience running, being a VFX supervisor, knowing how this works on productions, seeing day to day how that does, and so much experience creating tutorials already. It just seemed really meant to be. From a lot of different angles, and we're really excited and looking forward to feedback. Really excited to launch part one today and see what everybody thinks. I already can't wait for the other parts. It's just been really, really amazing to see this come together. And I think I'm rambling at this point, so I'm going to stop. And looking forward to hearing questions and talking to you all some more.
So thank you, Carol. So I think the important bit, again, was that recognition that call management was or is a scary topic. And for those of us that have taught it before, we know that it's not an easy thing for people to catch up. And even though it's supposed to be a little bit simpler, so on this journey, we decided obviously to partner with Mr. Victor, who is a pleasure to have worked with him again.
Pleasure is mine.
and Victor, so what was it, this roller coaster of this last year?
Well, it has been, let's say, interesting. Putting everything in perspective, you know, we have been in lockdown, which is great for this course, because if the world were not in a lockdown, I was going to be in a lockdown anyway, just doing this course, because it was like, you know, it was nice because Foundry, for the people that doesn't know the story, is Foundry just approached me a year ago and they told me, hey, we want to create a series of tutorials. Oh, that's very great. It's about color management. So he's like, what? Because as Carol said, color management is very scary. So, I mean, everybody is dealing with color management their own way. Something that I have been discovering even along the way, that I'm not the only one that is working, you know, as you can. You are just figuring out things on the way. So when I started designing, the first idea was like, let's create just a series of 10 videos of around 6-7 minutes. I said, oh, that's great. I mean, I think in a month, this is done. It's going to be great. And when I started creating the program, it's like, okay, HDR. Ah, great, great. HDR. Oh, well, to know HDR, you need to know this. Okay. And to know that, you need to know this other thing. And then you need this and this and this and this and this and this and this. And I ended with three or four just full things of, and he's like, oh my God, there is a lot in here. So after 2 months that I was creating the program, I said, guys, I think we have a situation, because this is going to be a very long and deep series, because for everybody to understand how serious is the matter, you need to go to the actual science. And science, you know, science is not an opinion. It's scary, but you can figure out if you know maths and you know what you are talking about. So what I was is learning about how people approach. And I saw that there is a lot of confusion, even on the internet, a lot of confusion between gamuts and color spaces, between the transfer functions, between HDR and SDR. So there is a lot of confusion. So the first thing was like, okay, let's put things in perspective. Let's create a very good fundamentals. That's why the course is called Fundamentals, because we are going to start to approach from the science bit. And I was very scary because I'm not a color science, but I was surrounded by very smart people that has been helping me massively. I cannot take the credit for this course, because this course is just the work of many, many, many people that has been correcting me and telling me more things and adding on top and just removing. Because I remember I did a chapter trying to explain a lot of things, and Juan said, man, this is already explaining there. You don't need to go that far. Remember with the monitor and the. Yeah. So sometimes I was so scared not to be clear that I was over explaining things. So just to deal for me, just to deliver in 1 hour and 20 minutes, that is the length of the first part. Everything in there is like, wow, there is a lot of information in there. And it's exactly no more, no less than everything that you need to attend the second part, that we are going to start digging into ACs and OpenColor.io and everything. But now that you start building a solid ground, you can start building tall buildings, because if you are building on the sand, everything is going to collapse. So that is what we did.
So I think that's a very important part of this, to kind of highlight. This is not, especially this first part, it's not about Nuke in general. It's actually about color management in general, right? And I think we talk about this with Carol on the Netflix thing, to make sure that this first part of the training as well is open to everyone. So as Carol was saying, it's not just us on Foundry, it's as a whole industry to really understand this. And especially thinking of artists at different levels. So especially kind of in the bigger facilities, you get all this stuff is hidden from you and already sorted. On the smaller facilities, you suddenly start hitting your face against the wall and try to understand some of this. So it was kind of to try to approach it from those two sides. So obviously, we can go now into different bits and pieces of what we have done and more in depth if we want to, depending how we want to explain some of this. There is already a few questions as well that we can answer. So please do put your questions on the questions tab. And we'll be answering some of those later. But so, for example, Victor, how did you approach color management before you did this a little bit? Or
it's like the Wild West. It is like, okay, let's bring it all. I mean, I was before working with my first project in ACES a few years ago, something like 5 years ago. It's because 2020 doesn't count. So yeah, it's 5 years ago. And in there, I started realizing how important and how easy everything becomes when the color is managed in the right way, instead of trying to figure out what you have to see, what they are going to see, expect, and then the editor is saying, oh, this is not working well. So when I was approaching before, I was just trying to match every monitor they were using. For instance, monitors for the editors, the projector for seeing the preview. So it's a real mess. And I have to admit that in that time, I was super scared of using the ACES, because it was something new and you know what's gonna happen and you don't trust something that is new, because why should I change if this is working, which is not working, by the way. But but you start approaching, and then I remember I called Gary, I think, at Foundry, or well, I called you. I remember that I called you 5 years ago. And then you guys were, as always, very, very helpful. And you know, I was a bit, you know, I wasn't that expecting like the super solution. It was to be so complex. And it was like, no, man, you just need to import this in this way and just get out in that other way. So that's it. Seriously? That's it? Yeah, that's it. Because the whole production is aligned with this ACES workflow. Seriously? So everything that I was doing, so how I'm going to match the monitor in the editor? No, 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 no worries. They are going to be, everything is going to be aligned because everybody is using the same maths for calculating the thing. So it was so easy that I couldn't understand that. Because for many years, we have been working in a way that was so difficult that I had a huge resistance just to believe that things can be easy. But of course, the price for that easiness is you have to learn what you are doing. Because if you don't trust, you have to trust the process. And to trust the process, you have to understand. So is that easy as you understand that everything that is ingested is ACES 2065 hash one? You are working in there in your department. You are working in ACCG. And as soon as everything leaves your department, it's AC 2065 hash one. And that's it. That's it. Because seriously, that's it. Of course, that's it because Nuke is ready for working that way because everybody in the software houses have been working very hard and before the production has been set up. But the thing is, you don't need to create something from scratch. You just need to join the train and just stay in there and use the same flow that everybody's using. So that is the management. It's not doing like jiggling or doing something like that. It's way, way easier. That's why I wanted to create this course in order to show how difficult it was before and how easy it is now. So there is even a chapter that I call the story of the score of the score transfer. That is something like 10 minutes about telling the story of how complicated were things. And as soon as you are going into the second part of the course, they're going to see like, seriously, is that easy? So, but of course it's easy when you know what you are doing. That is like, that is the key. I believe that is the key for everything. When you know what you are doing, everything is easy.
thank you. That's amazing. It was a really funny journey. And I think hopefully people will enjoy the Call Space Odyssey, which I think is, it was a marvelous bit of how to tell this. Carol, I was thinking just now, since you're part of the ACES and OCIO groups in both cases, how have these been part of the thought process with those teams and making sure that things get a little bit easier for everyone?
Yeah, easier for everybody. Easier for people learning it for the first time and easier for industry veterans who, like Victor, have been trying to do this for years. And I say easier, it's still, you know, we're not done. There are things that we have to work out and there will always be new things that we add and changes that we have to make. And problems that we're still solving. I see a question in the chat right now that's about, you know, to really trying to deal with gamut compression and crazy blue lights. And those are problems we're trying to solve. But yeah, in general, it's something we definitely keep at the forefront of our minds when we're working on these tools and working with different software vendors like Foundry and other things on, you know, how we use these tools too makes a huge difference of the partnership. You know, these tools on their own are just workflows or are just standards or just software libraries. Without the partnership of the whole industry with Foundry and Autodesk and a lot of other you know, members out there, they wouldn't succeed too. So it really is a huge industry effort from everybody involved.
Yeah, I think that's the main thing, obviously, is that we all recognize how difficult it has been in the past. And I think finally, in a way, we are all coming together to get some of this sorted. And I think with the hot topic, which is HDR, and how we're gonna get there, right? We already have problems with making sure things look the same. Let's add some more dynamic range to that.
More possibilities.
Exactly, more possibilities of like different HDR monitors that have different brightness capabilities, different contrast ratios, different viewing conditions. You know, it matters. Like, we don't talk about, I think that's an area we haven't even really gotten into a ton, but when you move to HDR, where you're sitting and what the light is in your room matters a lot more than it does in SDR. And like these are things that, like, it's not just having the right monitor. It's you know, how you deal with your surround too. So there's so many things we have yet to tackle.
All right. So I think I'm going to start kind of picking some of the questions that are on the question tab for us to kind of go over. Obviously, thank you, Mark and Nigel, who have been replying to everyone as well. So they are from the Foundry team, if you don't recognize them, and they're part of the Color team. So they're actually people working on OCIO and ACES and everything here at the team at Foundry. So hopefully we'll be able to get you some of those answers as well as we go. But since we're on HDR, let's ask this one, which is a bit interesting to start with. How common is HDR monitoring within VFX houses today, or are most HDR reviews still done at the finishing facility? Any of you wants to pick that?
Have you ever seen one? Have you ever seen one? No, I mean, usually, for what I've seen, of course, depends on the facilities, but even in big facilities, it's not that common that everybody has a HDR monitor able. So maybe they have, like, you know, it's like the old times. You have a room for checking, and you are working and try tricks and things that we are going to discuss, by the way, in the last part of the course, just in order to you know, to see something in there. But it's not that common to find that kind of a monitor. I don't know. What do you think, Carol?
No, I agree. It, right now, I mean, there just isn't. We're in this weird in between phase where I think we're doing the work to be ready for when it is viable to have an HDR monitor at a compositor's desk at the very least. We're not there yet. You know, we're trying to get to solutions around, you know, how do you get an OLED TV in your facility that can do a decent approximation, and you know, try and make that as realistic as possible, because let's just be honest, the barrier right now is cost, and we would recognize that. And so when we started talking about this series, that was like a big thing of like a lot of the questions that we get all the time on our team is, how are we supposed to finish, you know, do our visual effects for a show finishing in HDR when we can't see it? And we don't want to minimize the fact that it's hard. Obviously, but there are some things that you can do, and things that the Foundry are working on with Nuke too, to enable things that make that easier, that will be in later parts of this series too. So
saying that part of, in 13, we actually did, one is the monitor out implementation, and this is part of the reason why we added it to Nuke so much. It was to be able to have that access to HDR in an easier way, right? And then we also enabled the XDR for the Apple, in the case of Mac. You can now have the XDR monitor working properly with high dynamic range. And we are working more stuff towards that in future releases. And we are also working, as Carol said, I think the main thing at the moment is access to the screens and making sure that everyone can have a screen. At the moment, still pricey, so most people can't. So HDTVs and so on is kind of where we are. But we are seeing the market changing and bringing new equipment for all of us. Hopefully soon we'll be able to get better screens into everyone's hands. So that will help also quite a bit.
But there is something that I have to say about, you know, because companies or even individuals are going to think twice in terms of investing into new equipment. If someone is thinking that the HDR is going to happen something similar to stereoscopic or something, it's very wrong. HDR is here to stay. I mean, there is no way back with this. This is a new level of quality of the image. Is way more important than resolution, way more important than, I mean, I think it's the most important advance in color. So this is like a very, very new thing that is here to stay. So for the people that is scared about
your phone,
exactly.
Phone is HDR.
It's already in there. So if the phone is HDR, it means that we are in HDR, and that's it.
All right. So I'm going to continue down. Let's just go. For now, I just organize it by boats, people. So if you want the question to be answered, put more boats in there, and I'll try to get as many of those as I can. So I'm going to move us a little bit, kind of a little bit more into the use of ACES, but just for maybe just as a little bit of basic background on this. So if you were to start using ACES in your comms, does the rest of the pipeline also needs to use it? Some colorists won't budget yet.
Yeah, I mean, I can start on that one. The answer to that is no. That's not necessary. The benefits to working in ACES, in an ACES working space in VFX, still are huge and enormous, regardless of how your project is finishing. Now, obviously, there are some things that you'll have to work out pipeline-wise of making sure that you can, you know, match dailies, and you have what the colorist is going to use at the end, and you know that everybody's looking at the same thing. And obviously, that is one of the things that if you are in a full ACES pipeline, it makes it easier. But at the end of the day, we want to enable creative workflows, and forcing someone to use a tool that they're not interested in using, or you know that they have valid reasons for not using, is not where we want to be. You want to enable that creativity, and your VFX studio will hugely benefit still from working in ACES.
Yeah, and that is something that we are exploring in the first part of the course already, when we are discussing color spaces. The color spaces we are going to discuss in the second part of the course, the ACES, the big one, is just like more than you can see, literally. So you have unlimited color in there. So you can have the master of the VFX, and you can deliver them, and they are going to use a portion of that. Well, they can use whatever they want, is their thing. But the master you are delivering is always going to be timeless. So they can always get back to there and remaster in a full version. Of course, it's going to be a shame that someone is just going to stop the flow in there. But your job is going to preserve every tiny fraction of color that the human eye can visualize. So that is something to keep in mind. So absolutely, yeah, there is a lot of advantage in there.
All right. The next one, we kind of already touched into this. And maybe we just need to give one of the tips, but we'll cover this mostly on the course either way, but just to kind of go through that, right? Which again, as I said, this is one of the main questions and one of the reasons why we are doing all this course, which is, if you don't have a HDR monitor, how can we trick or do something to do QC if we are going to deliver HDR projects? I don't know if any of you wants to start.
Maybe. It's like grading color in a black and white monitor. You can more or less see the intensities. There are tricks. You can, you know, when you are working for cinema, I mean, as we have been working before, when you are working for cinema, in cinema you have way more, I mean, the color space is wider than the one that you have in your monitor. And we have been figuring out ways of displaying that. Well, with HDR, it's not exactly the same thing, because we're talking about distribution of blacks and whites and things, but still, you can get a simulation or an approximation in order to understand, because in terms of, for instance, in compositing, you just need to be sure that everything is matching in terms of levels. So maybe you are not displaying the right level, but at least you are able to see that they are both at the same level when you are talking about highlights, blacks. So that is, in terms of visual effects, that is the most important part. If we are talking about color, well, if you are a colorist, that is a very different story. But in here, well, yeah, cheap and dirty, as we have been doing in visual effects for the whole history. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'd agree. I mean, obviously, everybody, if you've worked on a, you know, in VFX on a title that's finishing in HDR, you've probably gotten the notes back from, you know, DI of like, your blacks don't match. or the levels are off, or I see this in the, or you start, they look at it and they see something in the window that was in SDR you can't see because you've hit the limit of your dynamic range. There, you know, there's the things, and the age trick is like the one trick that we can give right now that'll be obviously explained more detail in the videos. It's like, you know, use if you're in Nuke, you use the gamma slider, slide it up and down, treat it like a bracket, like, you know, and force your range, because you have the range in your EXR file. If you're working, especially if you're working in ACES, you have the range there. You just have to show it. And it's a hack. It's no fun, and it puts a lot more work on you as a visual effects artist. But it will save you a couple of back and forths between the DI.
Yeah, I think so. I was having a few conversations with different supervisors about this, and one of the main things is that is being a bit more diligent with kind of all our traditional QC processes that we have used, right? So the gamma and gain sliders, having tone map LUTs that can bring down and bring up as well in a specific way, so everyone check with the same ones. And that will give you that idea of where you are in the comps and where you are in the work. So when it gets to the eye, you don't have massive surprises. There'll be certain bits and pieces that, yes, you won't be able to see properly because you need something that actually displays that data properly. But you should be able to get the majority of it done and QC without it if you follow some of the practices. Again, we'll talk a lot more, and we'll do a lot more of this in the actual training. But cool. So now to what's next, because I was up to there, I haven't checked, and a lot of people have voted, so my order has swapped, and now I'm trying to go next. Well, this is kind of more a general one, but it is obviously, I imagine, a concern in different ways, and I think it's more about kind of just the management and making sure that things go out. So what about the export for client to review quick times, et cetera, and maintaining the color consistency?
Yeah, I mean, that a lot is like where, you know, that knowledge of having a consistent color pipeline such as ACES makes a big difference. Knowing, you have to know your color journey on your project, right? A lot of it starts with what was done on set and the lookup tables that they use to view on the monitors on set, and then create the dailies that editorial looks at, are mostly what you're going to be referencing throughout your whole visual effects pipeline. And so it becomes having the correct information in visual effects to replicate those movies. And usually those specs are discussed at the beginning of a project. You test things. You're usually exporting, I mean, for different stuff, you might be exporting just SDR, which would be Rec 709 Gamma 24 usually, and ACES has a default output transform for that. So if you're using ACES, it's that, and there might be a CDL with it. There might be a look, there might be something creative done on dailies. There might not be. So it's really just having that discussion at the beginning of your project, doing those tests. You're going to hear these things again of test, try things before your deadlines, before you need to deliver something, so that there are no surprises, so that you're not, but it might be, in the current state that we're in, something, it is something you have to check for every project. And it might be slightly different for every project. There's not one QuickTime setting to rule them all. There's not one output transform or creative look to rule them all. That's part of the fun.
Of course.
cool. And I think actually you make a good point there with under the current situation, it obviously makes it a little bit more difficult with everyone working from home, and then you are remoting in into a machine. So the pixels that you're getting back are not necessarily the full pixels, everything else. So obviously in the current circumstances, there is a few other bits and pieces that are blocking the workflow, but yeah.
Well, the nice thing is it's really easy to manage, because once you know the nodes and you know what's going on before and what's going to happen after, it's just really easy just to get into the pipe and just using a couple of nodes, for transformations, just for the look intent and the display transform and maybe a couple of things more. Just with that, you can be sure that you are delivering the right data without, I mean, because you did your test before. So if the test is working before, it's going to work always because it's maths. So maths are not going to change across time because you're using the same. That's why the color I/O is so important. The ACES compendium is so important. So everybody is going to be aligned. So that's why it's so exciting to have the new Open Color I/O V2 in there, because we are having more tools for allowing us to work easier.
Yeah. Cool. So this next one is actually quite more deep on it. And I think it's mostly because I think the answer could vary for this, but let's go for it, even though we can do it here. So how would you handle a gamut compression for plates ingest in ACES CG? It is especially difficult when keying blue screen in this color space, since the blue channel has a tendency to go negative in pixel values.
I can take this one, and it's obviously your workflows are going to be different, and Victor probably has some tricks. There's been a bunch of tricks up everybody's sleeve for a long time to deal with negative pixel values or in compositing, and visual effects are never Eddie's friend, right? It's like your worst enemy in a lot of things, and they happen for a couple different reasons, and not every solution fits the boat, but just know that there is a ACES 1.3 release coming out soon that has a gamut compression algorithm built into it. It was developed, and I'll be honest, it was developed for actually like highly saturated, high luminance level blue, like or LEDs that you get on set. You know, you have a really, really like a police siren, right? In red and blue is like, or a tail light of these things are like those examples that you see all the time where your pixels go out of gamut and there's no way to get them back in. They're lost, and you have a really hard time working with that in compositing and visual effects. That was what the tool was designed to do. And a side benefit of it will be if the same thing is happening with your blue screen values, it will help. It's not a one size fits all. It's not going to fix all of your problems. But it will help. A thing to look out for then, and Victor can probably talk a little bit more about this too, is it won't necessarily solve some of like your underexposed issues of like if your blue screen is underexposed or you're hitting noise floor on your camera, things like that. That's a different issue, and you may still have to go to the drawing board on creative solves for that. So,
yeah, I mean, in my case, what I will suggest is every shot is different. So depending on what you have right now, when you have these kind of problems, depends on what you have, you are going to use an approach or another. But I mean, what Carol said is, I have no further questions, Your Honor. Yeah, we have to deal with that.
Cool. all right. So, this is gonna. We could probably kind of. This is a funny one. So, how do you currently import sRGB into ACES? Now it looks the same as in new default color management.
Yes, that is not. That's on purpose. That's on purpose. Linear sRGB. Which is, you know, new default color management, does not equal ACES. And the expectation for those to look the same is part of the problem in some ways. There are a couple different, I think that's it's a great point and something we're dealing with on a regular basis. There are a couple tools within Open Color I/O I'm just gonna name them off and you can go look at them. And if you have questions later, we can add it to the things that we might cover in these tutorials. One is called sRGB texture, and it's in the utility spaces of the ACES configs, which are available in Nuke by default. You can try that to bring an sRGB source into ACES. And then you can also use the inverse of the ACES output transform from, you know, sRGB to ACES. But you, but the, when you apply your output transform back on the other side, the reality is that it's not the same as a default sRGB output transform. It is an ACES sRGB output transform, and they are not equal, and they will not ever look the same. Sorry.
But
it's looking better. It's looking better.
Depends on your definition of better.
No, it is true. That is true. It's always different.
But I think that's part. Carol, correct me if I'm wrong. But this is part of these basics that we're covering with Victor will help to understand why this difference exists. Right.
Yes. Exactly.
This is part of what we wanted to do with this course. Again, is that is part of the basics of, there is a lot of things that we have done as artists, always just click and match and until you get kind of the right image and you kind of understand the workflow, but you don't really understand what is happening in a lot of it. And I think this sRGB issue has always been a little bit of that, right?
Yeah.
So hopefully this course will help a little bit understanding why, even though both are sRGB, what's the difference that exists in that name and what they are actually the whole thing. And that's
what I can say is, you know, if you're working the an image that is a sRGB and you are working in a non-HDR range, is fine because you are delivering for regular TV, let's call it regular TV, not HDR TV. But when you are working in HDR TV, you want that sRGB image to be stretched in the right way. So because in any case, when you are working with an sRGB image for cinema or for whatever, that image is going to be corrected. Most of the times, it's going to be corrected by AI just to make it look great in the cinema. So the thing is, even when you are getting the what we can consider the right sRGB, it will never be the ending because you are going to end changing that sRGB. So who cares if it's the same or not? That's why I said it's better, because it's only better, it's not worse, it's just different. But the thing is, with the ACES sRGB, you have the option to stretch that into any possible color space that you can visualize. Without the ACES, you are going always to stay restricted to that sRGB linear space or whatever you are using in there. So there is a reason why, even if it's not looking the same, it's not actually a big deal. It's a problem if you are expecting them to be the same, but it's not a big deal because you are going to correct them anyway. So that is the point. That's why it's not that important. Well, it's important, but that is not a critical issue, I will say.
Cool. All right. So actually, well, we can continue. There is kind of a lot of, I think, and I expected this, that it was a lot going to go into dailies and grading and going into that side. This is actually a bit, again, this will be answered a little bit of the course, but this is a bit about that, right? Is we not create problems in creating dailies quick times if entire pipeline is ACES, since dailies quick times require CDLs and LUTs. So I think this is the exact type of thing that we answer in certain ways, which is understanding what are all these things.
It's really like you can do all of these things with ACES. ACES has, you know, a full workflow diagram that includes slots for CDLs, which is what might be referred to as, you've seen, a look modification transform or LMT. If you're looking at an ACES diagram, that's where that fits. And you can have as many of those as you want, as long as they're in a scene referred space. And then ACES has their default output transforms, so which is a LUT, which takes your data from scene referred to display referred and enables you to view it on the monitor of your choice. There are different ones for HDR and SDR and cinema and all of these things that are default to ACES. But it also allows the flexibility to go to a space and then use a custom lookup table, which is what we were talking about earlier. If a colorist doesn't want to, a director of photography has made their own lookup table and their look for the show, then these things are all possible. You just have to know and test, and preferably as early as you can.
Yeah, that is a key. Knowing as early as you can.
All right. Well, I could probably add this. I'll answer this one. But are the grading tools in Nuke evolving to allow the additional control afforded by the introduction of HDR? So, two sides to that. One, obviously, because Nuke is linear, the data is there, and we can already do the majority of that. So you can already do HDR without problem inside Nuke. There are some tools that do need updating, which I have seen another question down there, but I think it's actually lower, or I think Nigel or Mark has answered, and it's about the scopes and things like that. So there are certain tools that we need to update to make sure that you have full range and that you can look at the whole thing properly. And that we are doing. We have, again, the team, we are all working on that, and hopefully you will see some of those coming soon. So that's that. Well, this, I'm just going to put it up, but it's simply, so would you be able to go over the correct workflow for matte painters with ASUS workflow? And this one is, so obviously we can go over more again on the course with different bits and pieces about this, but I think the reason why I thought it was important to bring it up is because we were talking about before about QCing and tips on checking things. And one of the feedback that we have gotten throughout this time is actually one of the places that you find that issue a lot is with matte paintings. And normally it's because you are working with matte paintings in sRGB, in either Photoshop, but then you go into Nuke, you do certain bits, but it's about that workflow, how you bring that data from Photoshop and make sure you are actually in the high dynamic range. And that is one of the things that different supervisors that I have talked to have highlighted as one of the issues when you are checking with HDR. So I think the ASUS part is easy, is the HDR side that will add complexity to kind of the matte painters workflows. I think that is there anything that we can say quickly on this? I think that this will probably roll quite big, right?
Oh, yeah.
Not quickly. I think that I want to acknowledge the question and acknowledge that it is an area that a focus that needs some attention from a workflow side, for sure.
So. Right. So hopefully we'll get you some more answers as the next chapters of the course will come out. So cool. And where are we? Oh, Mark and Nigel have been busy. So, I actually don't know the answer to this, but maybe Carl, I think you probably will do. with the introduction of filmmaker mode on some consumer TVs, I noticed that the white point to 6,500 Kelvin, giving it a cinema feel, how should content creators practically approach this topic of white point?
I mean, it's an interesting, there's two parts of this sort of question here is like, what is the correct white point? And 6,500 or D65, as you might've heard it say, has been for SDR for a long time, a very, very common white point on your monitors, on your things, and now you're starting to see that on your TVs and filmmaker mode and things like that. And that's common. It is obviously not necessarily a cinema white point. It is different. And so I think that so there's these things of like acknowledging these differences. And really the important thing is from a content creator's perspective, being aware, being able to test, being able to look at your content that you're creating on a couple different displays at different levels of luminance and HDR and an SDR on a cinema projector if that's your target, be looking at your content on those displays and being familiar with the look that you're going for and what you're trying to achieve is of the utmost importance. It's that test, test, test thing, and it applies to the whole pipeline. As far as like these filmmaker modes on consumer TVs, we're really excited about that because it allows a user an easy setting to sort of emulate what the creator closer to what the creator might have been looking at when they were previewing their content. That can be good, and it you know, and then the user also has a choice to change it. And that's the thing with modern televisions is that you have that choice.
Cool. So I think, are we approaching? I'm trying to figure out how we're on time. I think we're okay. I haven't been screened yet, so I imagine we're right. So, so continuing on things, I was just trying to kind of go a little bit ahead, but now I went too ahead, and now I'm lost my day. So let's see. I think let's go with this. I think it's again about HDR. How big is the learning curve for mastering a project with HDR, assuming one half a modest indie budget friendly HDR monitor, or which we have kind of replied a little bit in about the difficulties to get monitors and so on, and use high-end Samsung TVs to preview your work. Is it worth working in HDR, or best to stick to SDR until you can do HDR correctly? Is but HDR better than no HDR?
I think it's better. I think HDR is better. More colors, more pixels, more explosions, more everything. Yeah, of course, it's better. It's better. You are going to have more final control. I mean, you are going to see the image as it's supposed to end if you are working in SDR, but you are just disregarding a big chunk of the information. So I will say that just even for learning, for experiencing, just working in HDR is something that works, because SDR content is from old age now. Is you have to move forward. I'm moving forward in HDR. That is what I think.
Yeah, it's hard. It comes from like the, I know we're almost at time, so I'll be quick. Of like in visual effects, I think access to any type of HDR monitor that'll give you some more luminance and a higher contrast ratio will help you find some of the QC issues that we're talking about. Obviously, if you're in a mastering space where you're finishing on as a colorist, the requirements for finishing a finishing monitor become a lot more stringent. But in visual effects, I agree with Victor. Is getting used to it, getting artists used to looking at it, all of that things. I think as long as you're aware that your HDR that you're looking at might not exactly resemble the HDR that your colorist is looking at. And starting to make those distinctions and educate around that is not bad, not a bad thing.
Well, Juan, it's that time.
I was saying that.
I feel like this could be a week-long discussion.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, one of the things we've been talking about is pulling together some panels and some roundtables on color management. So we'll be hoping Victor goes back to his workstation to help us with chapter two. So chapter one, as we told in some of the answers, is available today. We'd love your feedback. I'm going to give you our virtual events email because that goes directly to the industry marketing team who partnered with Victor and Netflix on this. I definitely want to, from the bottom of my heart, thank Victor and Carol for all of their work today and talking to you guys about such a passionate and complex topic. Really amazing questions. Our team's going to answer a few more questions. Shout out to Mark Kitchener and Nigel Hadley for helping us out. These are some of the biggest brains behind the color work in Nuke. So having them there answering your questions is awesome. We're going to take a look at the questions and see if we can put it into sort of a more formal Q&A document as well to share on our Foundry support portal. So you haven't heard the last from Foundry on color. You certainly haven't heard the last from Victor on color management. Please watch the course. Let us know what you think. Any teachers out there, we'd love to hear your feedback on sharing this with students. The course is hosted on Netflix's website, YouTube channel. So we might not see all the comments if you're posting them there. It's also on our YouTube channel. Also on our Foundry Learn page. So feel free to reach out to Foundry in any of the ways you do. And again, virtual events is a great way to reach us, virtual.events@foundry.com. And we're here to answer your questions and try and help the best we can. Enjoy making all those fabulous TV shows that I need to keep this lockdown going. Thank you to everyone on the call who's working hard to produce amazing Netflix content. And just thank you, everyone. This has been a labor of love for the team, and we really, all of us, have enjoyed this journey, and we're looking forward to chapter 2.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.